Good morning, Corno Church. It is a great Sunday to come together and lift our voices up in praise and in worship. To start with, I just want to lift Brian up in prayer as he's on the mend right now. Thankfully, he's had some really good medical care, and he should be back and up to musical speed with us shortly. And in the meantime, we'll continue to pray for you, Brian, and I'm glad things are going well so far. And that kind of leads me to this extra player we have here today. You may know him as your pastor, and I want to say that I'm really feeling privileged to be working together musically with him again. And I'm also going to take this opportunity to say, on behalf of the entire church and especially the worship team, I just want to thank you for a really good run these past few years. It's been great having your leadership, your teaching, and for me especially, the musical collaboration has been a great deal of fun, and it's a privilege to play with you today. And I'm going to cut it short soon before either myself or somebody else gets emotional, and we're just going to plow ahead and start off with Praise Is Rising.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. We're going to take some time now to pray a prayer of blessing and dedication over all of the tithes and offerings that have been received this week at our church. And I wanted to take this opportunity to say a word of gratitude and encouragement to all of the generous givers at the Corner Church who so faithfully partner with the Lord in the ministry of this church on the corner of Ritson and Beattie. Because of your generosity, the ministry of prayer, the teaching of God's word, and the work of evangelism has continued and does continue at the Corner Church. And, you know, since this is my last formal prayer for the offering at our church, I want personally to say just how inspired I have been to see the way God's people here at the Corner Church have responded so faithfully over the years, saying yes to the Lord's invitation to be generous. And it has truly been an honor for me to have been part of such a generous group of believers. And, you know, if it is true what the scriptures say, that the Lord loves a cheerful giver, then I have no doubt that the Lord has always smiled over the giving that happens here at our church from week to week. And with that thought, I'd ask you to please unite your heart with mine, and let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for all of the gifts of your Spirit. We thank you for the way you provide for us, both materially and spiritually. And we thank you for the many opportunities your ministry presents to us to be generous. We ask you to bless both the gifts and the giver for all of the tithes and offerings that have been received this week. And we ask, Lord, that you would give great wisdom to the leaders of the Corner Church, to the official board of the Corner Church, and to each one who is involved in the ministry of this church, that they would have your insight and your understanding as to how to steward and use these gifts well for your glory and for the sake of your kingdom, for the sake of those who will be touched by the love of Jesus through this church. We pray all of these things in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Good day, Corner Church. Today's scripture reading comes from Psalms 14, and the text reads, "The fool says in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They do abominable deeds. There is none who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven on the children of man to see if there are any who understand, who seek after God. They have all turned aside. Together they have become corrupt. There is none who does good, not even one. They have no knowledge, all the evildoers, who eat up my people as they eat bread, and do not call upon the Lord. There they are in great terror, for God is with the generation of the righteousness. You would shame the plans for the poor, but the Lord is his refuge. Oh, that the salvation of Israel would come out of Zion. When the Lord restores the fortunes of his people, let Jacob rejoice, let Israel be glad." And this is a reading of the word of the Lord. Praise be to God.
Coming up after this next song, we'll be going into our congregational prayer time. We'll be praying for our church, the community, the world, and you know, it's also an opportunity for us to, within our hearts, bring our own burdens, praises before the Lord. So I would ask you to prepare your heart to pray, and while you're doing that, we are going to sing, "I Will Pray."
The call, hearing your voice down
Thank you, Julie, for leading us into the Lord's presence like that. And now let's take a moment to pray a prayer together for the needs of our church community, for the needs of our city and our country, and for our world. Will you unite your heart with mine? And let's pray. Lord God, we thank you so much that you are a God whose ways are higher than our ways, a God whose thoughts are greater than our thoughts, a God who is immortal, invisible, the only wise God, and yet you are close to us whenever we call, and your presence is always with us wherever we go, though we go to the far ends of the earth or the depths of the sea, still you are there watching over and guiding and protecting and communing with us. We thank you for these truths that you've revealed to us in the scripture about how deeply you love us and how much you long to be in relationship with us. And out of that truth, we pray now for the needs of our church community. We think of all of those who are facing health issues and health crises, both great and small. We think of those who have recently come through surgery or who are waiting for surgery and waiting on doctors' tests to come back and surgeries to be scheduled and planned. Lord, would you be at work in all of these details, and would you be the true physician, the true healer, and the true, the great physician who provides for and meets for the physical needs of each one who calls on your name. And we ask for healing and recovery and restoration for each one who is wrestling or recovering from health issues today. Lord, we pray for the ongoing effects and the ongoing planning around the response to the COVID-19 pandemic, and especially as the Corner Church begins to move into next stages and next chapters of its reopening. We ask you, Lord, to continue to guide and bless and lead this community. We ask, Lord, that each one, as they are prompted of you to do so, would not be inhibited or hesitant to return to public worship as it's safe to do so for them, that any sense of risk or danger, that you would mitigate that you would give wisdom to all of the leaders who are putting protocols in place, and that the reopening of our church would proceed safely, but especially in a way that meets the needs of our church community, that ministers to those who are longing for community, and that ultimately brings glory and honor to the name of Jesus. We hold this up to you now, Lord, and we ask that you would give the leaders of our church great wisdom. We pray the same, Lord, in regards to this time of pastoral transition, and as you lead me out of my role as lead pastor of the Corner Church, and you have shown Pastor Jackie that you intend for her not to return to her role as pastor of a children and youth ministry, we pray for the leadership of this church, for the board of directors, for the ministry leaders, and each one who has responsibility for the things that happen in the life of this community. Would you encourage them? Would you give each one a great sense of hopefulness and expectancy, expectation for you to do great things? And Lord, even now you are preparing the right person to step into these roles, the right people to step into these roles. And may she or he already be feeling the tugging of your spirit in their heart for this work that you are going to call them to. And may she or he become clear who that person is in your time and in your wisdom. And as the leadership moves into this time of transition, would you guide and direct each step of the process so that it would honor you, that it would glorify you, and it would show how true it is what you said, that you alone will build the church, and as you do, even the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. So we lift up this great need to you now as your people, and we trust you, Lord, to provide above and beyond what we could hope or imagine. We pray, Lord, for the needs of our world, especially these days as we hear ongoing news of the effects of climate change and the way climate change is impacting so many lives economically, emotionally, and creating so many environmental crises and issues, especially during this summer season, as storms and droughts and so on seem to be exacerbated and increasing in number. We ask you, Lord, who created this earth and covenanted in the rainbow, Noah's rainbow, never to flood it again, but to take good care of it. We ask you, on the basis of that covenant, Lord, to heal our land, heal our earth, and change hearts and minds the human hearts and minds, so that they would see how changes in what we do may make a difference in the environmental crises that we are facing. We pray for the healing of our earth today, Lord, and we ask you, the Creator, to undertake for it. Lord, we pray for the church around the world in its witness. We ask you to continue to strengthen and inspire the witness of the church, especially, Lord, as in Canada, more and more truths about the residential school system and the very real atrocities that happen there are coming to light. And we do confess it, Lord, that it was people, men and women, bearing your name, the same name that we bear, who were involved and implicated in these events. Lord, would you give your church great humility, great willingness to own what is ours to own, and a deep, deep heart to do concrete, real things to seek reconciliation and healing of relationships with our indigenous friends and neighbors and brothers and sisters in the Lord. Lord, we pray today for a great awakening of responsibility and a great renewal in the life of your church around these issues. And may we have great understanding and great willingness to come to the table as brothers and sisters and friends and neighbors, and to seek healing and reconciliation, and to play our part in whatever that may look like. We do pray today, Lord, for the nation of Canada, as more and more provinces and more regions begin to open up and relax the restrictions related to COVID. We pray, Lord, that you would guide and direct this process, and that every step that is taken will keep folks safe, will bring about renewal and restoration of life and healthy, wholesome living, life together in community. And we pray, Lord, that in the coming days there would be a great revival and renewal in your church, and that we would see the church taking its place and fulfilling its role as a witness to your gospel in these days in this country of Canada. We pray these things in the strong and in the precious name of Jesus. And together as your people, we all say, Amen. So about 6 weeks ago or so, here at the Corner Church, we started a verse-by-verse study through a book of the New Testament called the Book of Titus. And we're going to finish that series today by reading the very last passage in the book of Titus, chapter 3, verses 12 to 15. And so if you have a Bible with you, I'd ask you to please turn there now to Titus chapter 3, verses 12 to 15, and let's hear the word of the Lord together. Paul writes, "As soon as I send Artemis or Tychicus to you, do your best to come to me at Necropolis, because I have decided to winter there. Do everything you can to help Zenos, the lawyer, and Apollos on their way, and see that they have everything they need. Our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good in order to provide for urgent needs and not live unproductive lives. Everyone with me sends you greetings. Greet those who love us in the faith. Grace be with you all." And may the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word. One of my favorite Christian missionary stories is the real life legend of Jackie Pullinger. Jackie Pullinger, the charismatic missionary from the UK who journeyed to Hong Kong back in 1966 to share the love of Jesus with the poor and the downtrodden. Now, if you've never heard of Jackie Pullinger before, all you need to know is that she was not a trained missionary. She was actually a classical musician, of all things, having graduated from the Royal College of Music in London with a specialty in oboe. But when Jackie was 22, she had a deep sense that God was calling her to be a missionary. Now, she didn't exactly know where she was supposed to go to pursue that call, but she wrote to a number of missionary organizations trying to find one that would take her on. And nobody would. She was turned down by every missionary group she contacted, and so she just decided to set out on her own. Now, originally, she had it in mind to go to Africa, but she had a vivid dream one night that impressed on her the idea of going to Hong Kong instead. And so, on the advice of a minister named Richard Thompson, she boarded a boat bound for Hong Kong with only $10 in her pocket and no real idea what she was going to do when she got there. She just got on the boat and she prayed that God would make it clear when it was time to disembark. Well, it's a bit of a long story, but the short version of it is that God directed Jackie eventually to plant a missionary work in a part of Hong Kong known as the Kowloon Walled City, which back in the 60s was one of the poorest, the roughest, and the most crime-ridden places in all of Hong Kong. God sent this 22-year-old oboist with no denominational support or formal training. He sent her to start a mission work among the opium addicts and the street sleepers, the gang members and the prostitutes that called Hong Kong's Kowloon Walled City home. And she did just that. I mean, the work that Jackie did in Hong Kong really is the stuff of Christian legend. Although it's not legend at all, it's all true. The addicts that the Holy Spirit healed, the lives that got turned around, the people who came to faith, all because God brought Jackie Pullinger to Hong Kong and she followed his lead. It's a beautiful story. But I was thinking about Jackie Pullinger's story this week in particular because it is, I think, it is a very beautiful example of the kind of thing we're seeing in our text here this morning. This almost throwaway bit at the end of Titus about how Paul is going to send someone to Crete to take over Titus's work on the island. And when he does, Titus is supposed to travel to a place called Necropolis because Paul needs him there. I mean, Jackie Pullinger's story is a powerful illustration of the thing that is underlying Titus 3:12-15 here today. This truth that the mission of God regularly brings people and sends people. At least, that's how I want to put it today. That the mission of God is continually bringing people and sending people. And just like God brought Artemis and or Tychicus, he brought them to Crete and then sent Titus on to Necropolis when they arrived. In the same way, if you will, the mission of God sent Jackie Pullinger from England and brought her to Hong Kong with the message of Jesus. Now, hopefully after saying all of that, it will become clear why I might have chosen Titus chapter 3, verses 12 to 15 for this sermon. This sermon, which will be, actually, it will be my last sermon here at the Corner Church. I mean, of all the texts to preach for a farewell sermon, you might have scratched your head a little bit when you heard that I would be using the closing verses of the book of Titus for my farewell sermon. Especially when you heard them read. I mean, all of this stuff about the travel plans of a bunch of ancient Christians that you never met, right? This seemingly ho-hum account of which Christian leaders traveled where and when way back in 65 AD. And let me say, I didn't choose it just because we started a verse-by-verse study in the book of Titus a month ago, and I'm simply determined to finish what we started. Although there is a little bit of that going on here, I will admit. But it's also because, and more importantly because, when I read the final verses of Titus, and then I thought about what's happening in the life of the Corner Church right now, I thought, you know, these four verses could have more to say to our situation right now than just about any other passage in the good book. But maybe it would help if I took a second to give you the background here so that hopefully you'll be able to see it too. You see, Titus was the pastor of the church on the island of Crete back in 65 AD. More specifically, he was the director of a network of house churches. He was the overseer of a whole group of small churches on Crete. But at any rate, he is a pastoral missionary leader, a church leader. And as we said in an earlier sermon about Titus, we know that Paul had stationed him here on the island of Crete to pastor the Cretan believers who lived there. Now, we don't know how long Titus was on Crete for. We do know that Paul had visited Crete sometime around 62 AD or so, and when he saw how chaotic things were for the church on Crete, he left his co-worker Titus on the island just to get things in order. And we sort of guesstimate that Paul wrote this letter that we're reading now. He wrote it sometime around 64 or maybe 65 AD. So it was probably only a few years after Titus got there, maybe 3 years at the most. Now, 3 years is not a long time to pastor a church. But from the other references to Titus that we have in the New Testament, it is pretty clear that this guy, Titus, was highly relational. Like, Paul often sent him to places where the church was in crisis or it needed some really strong TLC. I mean, one commentary that I read in preparing this sermon called Titus Paul's crisis intervention specialist, because that's how Paul seemed to use him, to intervene in churches that were in crisis. And you know, in church life, you don't develop a reputation as a crisis intervention specialist unless you have got some highly developed people skills, okay? And so I expect that in the 3 short years that Titus was working on Crete, the people there really came to love and appreciate him. And vice versa, that Titus really bonded with the Cretan Christians. And this part is just speculation for me, but it may be that when he read this bit in Paul's letter, this part here about how Paul is going to send someone to replace him on Crete, and when he does, Titus is supposed to leave Crete and head to a place called Nicopolis. I mean, for all we know, Titus's heart sank a bit when he read that. Maybe even more than a bit. I mean, Titus had just appointed the leaders who were going to look after all of the Cretan house churches, and he'd just finished training people to preach the gospel, and he'd just started to get to know this beautiful Christian community on Crete. And now, out of the blue, this message explaining that his replacement is on the way, and when his replacement arrives, it's going to be time for him to go. I mean, I can imagine him shedding a tear or two when he read it. Like, we do know from other places in the New Testament that it was often an occasion of great sadness when the time came for a Christian leader to move on from the church that he'd been working with. And so it's all kinds of likely that a tear or two fell when Titus read this note and he knew that his time on Crete was drawing to a close. But Corner Church, the mission of God brings people and sends people. This is what Christian work is like. It's what Titus signed up for. And it's what the Cretan church knew they were getting into when Titus arrived to help them out. And now God needs Titus to be with Paul at Nicopolis, and he needs Artemis and or Tychicus to be on Crete. And as hard as it is emotionally, and as hard as it is relationally, to see people come and go like that, the plain truth is, the fact that they're going and the fact that others are coming in, all of this moving about of Christian leaders, this is a sign that the mission of God is getting done. Now, I expect that most of you listening can see where this is going. Now, as I get ready to wrap up my final sermon here at the Corner Church. But before I do, let me just explain something. Because it may not be only Titus who's feeling sad today. There may be others. And it might be that we are all wondering, why? Like, why does church life involve all of this moving about of people? You know, we form these deep bonds with them, and we come to love them. We call them brothers and sisters in the Lord, and we call them friends in Christ. And just when we're starting to feel comfortable and cozy together, God sends some of us on to new things, and he brings in new folks whom we haven't met yet, and we have to do it all over again? I mean, you and I would be excused if we wanted to ask God why he does this the way he does. And Corner Church, I don't have a great answer for that question today, except to point out to you that our God is himself a missionary God. I mean, when he brought his people out of Egypt way back in the Old Testament, and when he was leading them through the desert to the promised land, our God did not have them build some great big huge temple for him to dwell in, like all of the other gods of all of the other nations had. I mean, yes, eventually they did build him a temple, but that's not the way it was at first. And it wasn't a temple where his glory first came to dwell, was it? Does anyone know what it was? Like what God's glory dwelt in back in Moses' day? It was a tent. A portable, movable tent. They called it the tabernacle. And wherever God brought the people to, they set up the tabernacle, and his glory came to dwell there. And then when it was time to move on, they packed up the tent and they moved it to their next location. Because Corner Church, our God is a missionary God. And as a missionary God, he is constantly on the move, so to speak. And as he does move, he is constantly sending people and bringing people with him. I mean, he sent Abraham, like way back at the start of the story. If you know this part of the story, you'll know that he called to Abraham out of the blue, and he said to him, come with me, Abraham, to the place that I will show you, and I will make you into a mighty nation that will be a blessing to the whole earth. And even though Abraham didn't know where he was going, Abram heard the call and he followed. And God sent Moses, right, later on to bring the people out of Egypt. And when it was time for them to enter the promised land, he sent them a new leader, a guy named Joshua. And then once they were in the promised land, he sent them a new leader, a guy named Samuel. And I mean, We don't have time to review the whole entire story of the Old Testament, but if we did, you would see that this is one of the most common characteristics of our Lord. He is a sending and a bringing God, one who is always sending people and bringing them to accomplish his mission. And, of course, God's sending and his bringing came to its ultimate head, didn't it? Its culmination when he sent his only begotten Son, he sent Jesus into the world on a mission to save the world. Right? So that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. I mean, Corner Church, if you really want to understand all of the sending and the bringing of people that goes on in church life, the place you really need to look to is to the person of Jesus Christ, our missionary God, come in the flesh, the one who came into the world as Savior of the world so that you and I would come to know how good and loving and compassionate and true God really is by seeing it in the flesh, in the person of Jesus Christ. I mean, after all, this is the mission. This is the mission that everyone, everywhere would discover how good and loving and true God is by encountering his goodness and experiencing his love and accepting his truth through faith in Jesus Christ. This is the mission. It's the reason that he sent his only begotten Son into the world in the first place. And it's also the reason that he sent Titus to Crete when he did, so that the people of Crete might meet Jesus. And it's the reason he's sending him on now to Nicopolis and bringing in Artemis and or Tychicus to take care of the church at Crete when he goes. Because, well, apparently there are some people in this place called Nicopolis who need to meet Jesus too. And Titus just so happens to be the best person to make the introduction. It's the mission. And it's the reason God sent, you know, he sent Jackie Pullinger to Hong Kong back in 1966. Two, so that the people living in the squalor of the Kowloon-walled city might meet Jesus. It's the mission. And it's the reason, I mean, not to say anything too spiritually grandiose today, but I really believe this is true. It's the reason he sent me and my family from Karenport, Saskatchewan to Oshawa, Ontario, back in 2009 to help in the work that a little church plant named The Freeway was doing in the city of Oshawa to introduce people to Jesus. You know, I still remember the weekend that Danny and I arrived here to candidate for my first pastoral appointment. That's what they call the pastoral interview in church ministry. You don't just interview for the job, you candidate for the appointment, which means that you visit the church over the course of a couple of days and you have a extended interview with the search committee, you interview with the board, you meet with the congregation at some sort of church-wide social event, you preach on the Sunday morning, and then afterwards there's a congregational town hall type meeting where you get asked all sorts of questions like, well, one of the questions they asked me was, how did you propose to your wife? I mean, I don't know if every candidating weekend goes like that. I've only ever had one, but that's certainly what it was like for me. when Danny and I came to candidate at the Freeway Church, which is, of course, one of the two congregations that now make up the Corner Church. And there was lots of laughter and also lots of stress, I won't lie, laughter and stress mixed together. And I met the congregation, and they all, I mean, you all met me and Danny, and we, all of us, tried to discern if God really was sending me to Oshawa and bringing the Freeway to me. And I'll never forget it. While we were pulling out of the parking lot after our last big event for the candidating weekend and everything was said and done, Danny turned to me and she said, "You know, even if they don't call us, I think we should move here just so we can attend this church because it is such an amazing group of people." And she was joking, I think, about the idea of moving across the country just to attend the church, but she was not joking about how amazing the people were at this community of faith. And, you know, 12 years later, because yes, the church did call me after all, and God did send us to Oshawa from Saskatchewan. And 12 years later, I want to say that it is still true. Even though the congregation looks very different from how it looked 12 years ago, and not everyone's the same, not by a long shot, they're not. I mean, if anything, it's twice as amazing as it was, right? Because in 2018, the Freeway merged with Gateway, and we became the Corner Church. And it is still an amazing group of people. And you know why, don't you? Because, like I've been saying, our missionary God is constantly sending people and bringing people. He's done that time and time again at the Corner Church. I mean, I don't want to put anyone on the spot in a video recorded sermon like this, so I won't name names. But really, I can't keep track of the number of times God has brought someone to our community, seemingly out of the blue, and yet their contribution to the life of our church was just exactly what we needed to accomplish his mission for us at just that point in time. Or the number of times someone, or a couple, or a family started attending our church, right? And, you know, over the years, their involvement in the life of our community helped us to move in a whole new direction as we followed God's mission in new ways. I mean, the story of Gateway and Freeway coming together to form the Corner Church, I mean, that's an example of this times a trillion, isn't it? God sent the Freeway to Gateway, right? And he sent Gateway to Freeway. And why? Why did he do that? So that Freeway wouldn't have to set up and tear down their church in a school gymnasium anymore? No. So that Gateway wouldn't have to wonder where their next pastor was coming from anymore? No. I mean, yes, those were both things that happened as a result of these two congregations coming together. But they're not the reason it happened. The reason it happened, the reason we did it, and the reason God blessed it, was so that we could accomplish his mission together in ways that we just couldn't do apart. Corner Church, it's the mission. It's the mission. That's the key to understanding pastoral change and transition and the moving about of people that happens in church life. That's the way to process it, and that's the way to make sense of it. Because the natural human approach is just to think about, you know, how will this change affect us, right? I mean, will it change our relationships? Will it affect our routines? Will it disrupt our comfort zones? I mean, let's face it, the change that is coming for Titus in this letter, as he learns that he's going to have to pack up on Crete and head off to Necropolis, that change is going to do all of that and more for him, isn't it? It's going to disrupt his comfort zone and impact his relationships and change his routines. And if we only look at it from a human level, that's all we'll see is the disrupted routines and the impacted relationships and the affected comfort zones. But if we look at it from God's perspective, if we think about it in terms of the stuff God is doing to accomplish his mission, the mission, right? The mission of making sure that everyone everywhere has the opportunity to meet Jesus. If we take a missional view of it, then we will be able to trust God as we go through it. The kind of pastoral transition that we're reading about here in Titus chapter 3. We'll be able to trust him through it. I mean, it won't necessarily be any less sad for us as we do, but we'll be able to see God at work in it. And so long as we know that he is in it, we will know that it's good. I am saying all of this for reasons that I hope are obvious, because this is my last sermon here at the Corner Church after 12 years. And yes, I know that for folks who came to the Corner Church from Gateway, it will only seem like three years. And for folks who came to the Corner Church from Freeway, it will seem like a full 12 years. But either way, it's years. Years of sharing the gospel with you and teaching you the word of God. 12 years, something like 532 sermons. I counted this week. 532, 144 celebrations of Holy Communion together, countless baptisms and Bible studies and weddings and funerals and prayer meetings and hospital visits. And Corner Church, I can't think of a greater privilege than getting to pastor this community as God has accomplished his mission among us these many years. And yet, now, our missional God is sending me somewhere else. Not necessarily to Necropolis like he did for Titus, but somewhere new. And in his time, in his wisdom, he is going to bring someone new to the Corner Church as well. And I guess I just want to say something here at the end to thank you for the rich blessing it has been getting to be your pastor and getting to share life together with you all, getting to work with you on the mission of God in this particular corner of his world. I want to say thank you for that. But more than that, I want to encourage you today. I want to encourage you because so long as this community of faith stays on mission, okay, so long as it is committed with all of its heart to introducing people to Jesus, Like so long as this church continues to be about what it has always been about, the mission of God, then it won't matter if it's Titus pastoring it, or Artemis, or Tychicus, or even Pastor Dale. Because if we stay focused on the mission of God, we can be assured that God will accomplish his mission among us wherever he sends us and whomever he brings to us. Corner Church, I'm having trouble finding the words today to say all that I have in my heart this morning, that I want to encourage you with. But I do want to bless you richly for the rich gift that this community of faith has been to me. I want to give you a blessing. And so maybe instead of trying to find my own words this morning, they're sort of failing me, I will simply end my sermon, this my final sermon here at the Corner Church. I'll just end it with the same blessing that Paul ends his letter to Titus with. His words. Corner Church, may grace, may God's grace be with you all. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Dale, for a really relevant message. I know personally I've been feeling some anxiety going forward, and I'm sure looking around the room, you know, we all have. And, you know, we know that God's at work, and just because people are moving around, like you said, the work of the Lord's being done. And on that note, I would like us to respond with Build Your Kingdom Here. Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope. Wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in.
So hell can't stop.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the cross and for salvation, and we just ask that you help us to move forward in these times of transition, that we may use the gift that you've given us to build your kingdom here on earth to prepare us from heaven. In the strong and precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. In closing, we're going to sing Carry Your Love. Sing up real loud at home and here as well.
We are called out, we are ransomed, we are not of the world we're in. We are chosen, we are blessed to bring light to the lives of men. So Father, sow your seed, give us life in community. Wake us from our sleep. This is your time, this is your place, and we are vessels for breaking under your grace. We are led by your Spirit. You have redeemed us by the blood of your Son. Sunlight, you are morning, you are hope of a brand new day. You are comfort, you are blessing, and you wipe all our tears away. So change us from within, render miracles from our sin. Remind us once again, this is your time, this is your place, and we are vessels for breaking under your grace. We are led by your Spirit. You have redeemed us by the blood of your Son.
Thank you so much for joining us for this online service today. And since this is my last benediction for my last online service here at the Corner Church, I do want to say a sincere thank you and God bless to everyone who has made my ministry here in this community of faith so rich and so rewarding. We have grown together and we've encountered God together and we've learned how to follow him together. And it's been a great privilege to have been your pastor for the time that the Lord had me here. And I'm grateful that friends in Christ are friends for eternity, and that even though I'm stepping down from my role as pastor here, the rich friendships that we've formed doing God's work together, those aren't ending. Yes, they're changing a bit, especially in the short term as we all discern our next steps with the Lord, but they're not ending. and I will always cherish everything that God did with us and through us and for us as his people here on the corner of Ritson and Beattie. And with that said, let me now offer you this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And the grace of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.